This is Sarah Willey. I am here from Outlier Research and Evaluation. I'm an education researcher, and I'm joined by my colleagues Daphne Sajous-Brady, who is a learning specialist at Wolcott School, as well as Erica Roberts, who is a computer science teacher at Wolcott School. And we're going to kind of tag team this presentation here so that you can hear from all of us. I'm going to kick things off, and then I'll pass it over to Daphne, and then we'll pass it over to Erica. So first of all, thanks for joining us. We're happy to have you here. And you know, as much as you're probably interested in hearing from us, we're certainly interested in hearing about the experiences that you've had this past year with computer science principles, and with any work that you do with students who have specific types of learning differences. So as Maria noted, there's the little chat box in the far bottom right of the screen that you see, and please don't be shy. Feel free to kind of like introduce yourselves, tell us what your role is in computer science education there and where you work, and continue to kind of put in some questions along the way. We have a few spots where we're going to specifically kind of like say, hey, we want to hear from you about your experiences, and then we'll be looking to see what you type in that chat box to share with us and with others on this presentation. So I think with that being said, some of the goals that we have today, I heard a sound. I didn't know if that was Maria. So some of the goals that we have today are to provide a brief overview of the exploratory research study that we're doing that's really focused on students who've been diagnosed with learning differences and who should certainly be included in all of our broadening participation efforts in computer science. We're also going to highlight some student experiences in the AP CSP class at Wolcott School, and then we're going to end up by giving an overview of some of the instructional practices appropriate for students with diagnosed learning differences like those in our study that you're going to hear from snippets from today, as well as, you know, the typical range of learners that you're going to find in any type of classroom. So to begin, you'll see that we use the term learning differences. And this is the term that we use to describe students with specific learning disabilities, as well as those with attention deficit disorders. And, you know, we want to just point out a few little things here as we start our talk. The term or the category learning disability is different than other disorders that you may be familiar with, such as, you know, autism spectrum disorder, some intellectual disabilities, emotional disturbances. And it's also important to note that students can have multiple types of disabilities or subcategories of disabilities, right? It's not something that's exclusive. In our work, our particular focus happens to be on those students who have been diagnosed with learning disabilities and related attention deficit disorders, as this is where, you know, our expertise lies, as well as it's the largest groups of students receiving special education services in schools in the U.S. We also should point out here that the system for diagnosing these students with disabilities, it's not perfect. You know, at times it's inconsistent. Kids are oftentimes underdiagnosed or overdiagnosed for a whole range of reasons that we don't have time to discuss today. But that's just, you know, something else to kind of keep in mind. And here's the first little prompt for you. Did you work with any students in your CS classes this past year that had these types of learning differences? Don't be shy. We'd love to hear from you. So Daphne, Erica, and I and our colleagues at Outlier Research and Evaluation and at Wolcott School were involved in a researcher-practitioner partnership exploratory research study funded by the National Science Foundation. And that's what's led to this webinar. And there's a lot of collaboration that we do on this work, you know, really pulling from the different types of expertise that we have on the Outlier side and on the Wolcott School side. And we wanted to give you just a quick snapshot of some of the type of work that we've been doing the last year and a half that is specific to thinking about computer science principles, in particular, in our case, looking at the code.org version of CSP and thinking about ways that we can provide guidance for teachers to make the materials more accessible for students who have differences. So part of the work that we've been involved in has been looking really carefully, reviewing the code.org lessons, identifying places within those lessons where we can suggest alternate, you know, instructional practices and approaches for some of the activities and materials that are there, so that they're going to be more accessible for students who learn differently. And these suggestions that we come up with have come from what is known in other non-CS content areas about what works for these particular learners, as well as the experience and expertise of the Walcott Learning Specialist. So throughout the year, as we've been doing some of this work, using some of these, trying out some of these adjustments with the lessons in ACS classroom at Walcott School, we've also been collecting data from both the CS teacher teaching the course, Ms. Roberts, and the students to learn about their experiences with the materials and the types of challenges and supports that they're encountering. So you can see in the bottom left corner of the slide here, this is an overview of some of the student-specific data, some of the collection methods that we've been using this past year. And as we've been involved in this work, what we found is that many of the instructional practice recommendations that we've generated, that we've come up with and used, are really kind of generally applicable to a range of some of the different CSP versions that are out there and CS high school classes in general, right? So some of these things are specific to the code.org version of CSP, but many of them are very general and can be used in a range of different CS classes to make the learning experience, you know, really more accessible and engaging, not just for students who have diagnosed learning differences, but also in many cases the whole range of students in that class. So, you know, along the lines of universal design for learning, that approach, many of these types of instructional practices hit on similar things to universal design for learning, whereas they emphasizing how information is presented, how students demonstrate their understanding, and how students interact and engage with those materials. So one of the data collection mechanisms that we've used, we had a pre and a post survey for this school year to find out about a range of things from students, and one of them was specific to student attitudes and feelings about computer science in general, as well as specific to that computer science principles class. And, you know, you'll note I put down here in the bottom far right corner, the N for this is 9. So, you know, it's a fairly small sample. This is really just descriptive kind of feedback, but we had about 9 out of the 11 students in the class who completed all of the end of the year survey that we're going to be looking at here today. So some of the questions that we were interested in asking of the students had to do with, as you can see on this slide, getting at their, you know, better understanding their the level of enjoyment and interest in computer science in general. As you can see here, about 3/4 of the students in the class said that computer science is interesting to them and they want to learn more. Over half of them enjoyed the computer science work. And then about the class was fairly divided, I would say, as to whether they thought that computer science, whether they thought it was fun to learn and solve computer science problems. We also wanted to know about their self-confidence in computing, and what we found in some of the questions that we asked was that over 3/4 of the students agreed with statements that they now have the skills and the ability to learn computer science, and over half of them agreed that they're capable of solving difficult computer science problems. And here's another place where we're interested in hearing from you. You know, what are some of the strategies that you use in your classrooms to build student confidence in computer science? We know that oftentimes in classes, particularly like CSP, that's designed to be accessible for students who may not necessarily have a lot of background experience in computer science, but there's often a mix of students, those who do have experience and those who don't, and sometimes you may have very different confidence levels. We also wanted to know if students had more of a fixed mindset about learning computer science, meaning, you know, this idea that you're either good at it or you're not, and you can't really change that, or a growth mindset, meaning they believe that they can learn and improve in their computer science skills to some extent. And in these range of questions that we asked, we found that, you know, almost all but one student kind of rejected the idea that you're good at computer science or you're not, right? That fixed mindset idea. So almost all of the students did not agree with that. Over 3/4 of them agreed that anyone can really learn and improve their computer science skills. We did have 2 students that were outside of that who had some slightly different perspectives on that. Then we wanted to know if students thought that over the course of the year that their skills and ability to tackle computing problems, if there was an increase in that, if those grew, specifically related to the computer science course. And we found, again, that over 3/4 of the students felt that their computing skills did, in fact, increase because of the class. And again, we had 2 of these students who were kind of on the opposite spectrum. They felt that their skills decreased. Over half of the class felt better able to solve problems at the end of the course. So, you know, again, in regard to some of these questions we asked about attitudes and feelings, we had a few of these kind of 2 students who exhibited a pattern in their responses where, you know, their attitude, feeling, self-assessment of ability was related to, you know, lower enjoyment, self-confidence, and kind of this rejection of an idea of growth mindset perspective. Those things seem to be kind of correlated with lower self-assessment of growth in computer science for them. So, you know, even within this small class of students who all have learning differences, there's variation, just as you would see in any classroom with a wide range of learner profiles. At the end of the year, you know, we also did interviews throughout the year with students, and we did a final interview, and in that final interview, we asked students to tell us what advice they'd give to other CSP teachers about how to approach teaching this very new class. And that, you know, we think that this provides insight into the kinds of interactions and activities that students most value in this particular population, as well as the particular aspects of the course that stood out to them as things that teachers should really be aware of when preparing to teach this course. You know, these students are in a unique position where they're really the experts in this now too, because they're in that first class that went through this course, and they have a lot to share about their experiences. And so this is a summary of some of those main themes that we heard students describe. So some students talked about the importance of teachers providing examples, giving example problems, working through some of the challenging ones together, some of the harder ones, giving an overview of the work, meaning kind of give them a heads up so that they know what to prepare to do, so that they can really think about how they're going to plan out and manage their time, offer explicit feedback about student work, you know, not just when there's an error, but give them some information, some feedback, helping them to understand what it is, where they went wrong, and what they could do to kind of address that. Think about the different, think about pacing, think about the different experience levels that are going to be in the class. Some students talked about that, you know, you could potentially start out slow, see how each kid is doing. If you see that there are a number of kids who are faster or slower, think about ways that you can maybe adjust the class to account for the needs of the different students in regard to pacing. Build an extended time for work for those who need more. One student suggested having time at the end of the week. That's catch-up time because students oftentimes feel pressure. They feel to kind of figure out things, and they don't want to just blow through and try to get things done. They want to understand what they're doing and why. And another student talked about, you know, the fact that there's a lot of new vocabulary that's introduced in CSP, and so it's helpful to have kind of reoccurring time set aside for students to really dig into that vocabulary. So again, we'd be interested in hearing what kinds of things you heard from your students about the CSP class this last year. So before I hand things over to my learning specialist colleague, Daphne, we have 2 videos. So I just want to give you a chance to hear really directly from some of the students. Again, this is ask them questions. questions about what advice would you give to teachers about things that they should think about as they're planning to teach this class. And this is advice, some of it relates to this idea of helping students be able to kind of create a class plan and manage and plan out their time, offering instruction in multiple ways, and also this getting at that the fact that oftentimes you're going to have students who have different experience levels and are moving at a different pace in the class, and how to think about that.
All right, thank you, Sarah.
Yep.
And can everybody see the black screen? That
yep.
looks like it's going to play a video. Great. Okay. So one quick thing, make sure that your phones are muted during the video, because otherwise there might be echo. So yeah, I'm playing it.
What advice would you share with teachers and other schools about how to structure and teach the computer science principles course for all kids?
I think when you have a class that has, you know, a lot of distance between, you know, how fast kids work, how the speed at which they perform, you should sort of section them into groups that would be allowed to sort of advance at their own pace. That way nobody gets held back by people who are slower than others, helpful to work in.
Probably to go at the pace of the students, the way they could go.
I think presenting it in different ways, like visually, or kind of writing it down differently, make it much easier. What is nice is there's videos kind of explaining it and text.
All right, thank you, Maria, for playing those for us. And so now I'm actually going to hand things over to, as I said, my colleague Daphne at Wolcott School, who is a learning specialist. And she's going to spend some time talking about some of the specific instructional practices that you can integrate into your own CSP or other CS classrooms that address what we know about the student experience, as well as particularly the types of things that work well for students who have been diagnosed with learning differences.
All right, thank you, Sarah. So hello again, good evening. I'm Daphne, a learning specialist at Wolcott School. I was involved in this research project by reviewing lessons prior to instruction and then suggesting adjustments based on what I perceived as posing challenges to students with learning differences. Also, I assisted in reviewing student and teacher feedback after lessons had been implemented to tweak instructional strategies accordingly. So from the teacher and student feedback regarding experiences in the computer science principles class, we identified four aspects of the instruction that routinely needed some adjustments. We found that students benefited from instructional adjustments when new terminology was introduced, particularly when it was like within a lengthy verbal introduction, as well as during exploratory projects, collaborative work, and programming. So in our analysis, we found that these four areas of challenge were primarily related to difficulties with attention, language processing, and executive functioning. So given what we know about student experiences and challenges in the CFP class, we want to share with you some instructional strategies that you can use in your classrooms and on your materials to make CFP curriculum more accessible and engaging for this important population of learners. And we believe that many of these general practices will benefit a wide range of all learners in your classroom, too. So in CFP, lessons often began with verbally presented information, which usually contained sophisticated language, technical information, and new vocabulary. The teacher guide, provided usually highlighted what should be said to students, but there were no suggestions made regarding how to support this verbal information with visual or written supports. So at the bottom of the screen, you see an excerpt from the teacher manual, and you can see the new vocabulary being introduced and some suggested script about how to, you know, go about introducing it. Yet there's no reference to written material to support the introduction of these new terms. And in this case, it's protocol and BIT. And then often too, another like useful tool that was provided, you know, by the curriculum was these introductory videos that were used to explain information. The videos were actually really valuable. They helped illustrate concepts visually, but sometimes the rate at which the information was presented was very fast. A new terminology would sort of like quickly flash and move around the screen, and although that made the videos engaging and entertaining, it was done in a manner that often felt like a little too fast for our students to sort of hold on to all the technical terms that were being introduced. So we found that through observation and sort of feedback from students, we found that, you know, kids who had trouble sustaining focus, you know, while watching videos, that would be particularly true for students with attention issues. You know, they had kind of hard time sort of like sustaining their attention during that time. And also for some kids, learning new vocabulary in general and retaining it is a challenge, just, you know, students with language disorders. And so for those students in particular, the way the vocabulary was introduced, you know, sometimes pose, you know, some pretty significant challenges. At the bottom of the slide, you'll see a quote, you know, so two quotes, you know, from the same student who had who has a language disorder. You could see at one point, the student said the video was going by so fast. And then in the second quote there, you know, quote says, the biggest challenge was understanding the difference between routing traffic and broadcasting. Student says, I didn't really know what broadcasting meant in terms of computers. So you can see in this lesson, they were introduced to two new terms or terminology. And in some cases, you know, what can pose like an additional hurdle for students is when a term that they've heard like elsewhere is actually used in a new context in computer science. And so then again, too, like just understanding the multiple meanings of words in certain contexts was challenging for the students. So what we found, you know, to be really helpful was to maintain a glossary. What we did, you know, at Walcott, our computer science teacher actually had a shared Google Doc, and terms were just added, you know, to the Google Doc, you know, as, you know, the curriculum progressed. So the students had access to it. They didn't have to, you know, write their own definitions or do a lot of copying. It was just really readily available for them to access, you know, in the shared document that was maintained and supported by the teacher. And then whenever like written terms or definitions or key information is presented, like in a lengthy introduction, we would put them on a presentation slide or place them on, you know, a whiteboard. We also found that watching the videos twice was really useful. So, you know, a lot of times like have the students sort of sit back and, you know, watch the video all the way through the first time just to kind of get the bigger picture, bigger concept, with the understanding we're going to return and watch the video more slowly and pause and take notes and clarify when necessary. Another key thing was the guided notes. So providing guided notes mean that there's some text already written in the notes. And so students just had to listen, you know, carefully to the video or to the teacher and sort of complete the notes, you know, so like fill in the blank to sort of lighten the load in terms of note-taking, because that could also be challenging for some students with learning differences. But the guided notes really sort of helped them like focus on key information and gave them reference materials for the future. And then it was really important to just check for understanding regularly. So just something for you guys to think about and respond to too is, which of these strategies do you already use in your GS classroom? Right. Another sort of challenging aspect of the CS curriculum was the exploratory nature of the curriculum. There were quite a few projects, you know, that where students weren't necessarily given specific guidelines. You know, and in fact, like this type of project-based work, which is a big part of CSP. Students are expected to learn by investigating, exploring, possibly trial and error. And for some students, like, this is a real challenge, especially with students with executive functioning difficulties. And so here, like, we posted, you know, sort of two examples of projects that were, you know, that did pose some challenges for our students. And so one slide is a research project on either big data or cybersecurity dilemma. In this activity, there was little explanation about the expectation for student work. And then in the other example, students are expected to determine how an everyday occurrence can be represented digitally. And you could see there, like, a sort of like a larger sort of, you know, an event is taken, and they're supposed to break it down into certain components. And they're given an example, but they're supposed to transfer that to a whole new event of their choosing. So what made these tasks challenging for our students? Sometimes choosing a topic, a point of focus, was really hard, especially for students with some attention, executive functioning issues. And then once they had selected a topic, actually finding appropriate sources was a challenge. I know a lot of people talk about, like, web searches and finding credible sources. You know, like, that exists. That's also true. But we found that some of our students, as they were, like, looking for sources, just finding information that was at appropriate, like, reading level or a background level, you know, in terms of, like, their CS knowledge was also hard. Some kids have trouble, like, developing a plan by breaking the task, you know, into smaller components. And then another aspect is there are, for some kids, like, it's difficult for them to sort of build knowledge as they tinker or explore, you know, sort of like a cumulative sort of like conceptual understanding. If you see down at the bottom, this quote here sort of reflects, you know, some of the comments that we heard from students, but as well from the teacher. You know, the student said, it was hard to get started and choose and get the basics of my argument down on paper. It was hard to choose which option I'm going with and then how I'm going to argue it and what my points are going to be and how to use those points. So you can see, like, just some difficulty sort of finding ground and moving forward in this project. Okay, so what did we find was useful? We found, like, modeling, you know, was really important, providing, like, additional models, you know, beyond possibly in the manual, providing exemplars, and then really going through examples, sometimes several examples. And then also just providing steps to how one can explore. So for some kids, like, you know, giving them some, like, the internal dialogue that, you know, somebody could explore and thinkers develop. We gave them some of the, you know, some guidelines with that. We also present students potential options. You may not walk into the class, like, with sort of, like, options of topics. You may not hand a topic to the student immediately, but if the student's really having some difficulty, having some topics that you could sort of share or guide them to, especially if you know there's some good sources that the students, once they, you know, if they've selected the topic that you're suggesting. And again, just circulating, assisting, and providing consistent feedback really seem to be beneficial. Okay, so now I'm going to turn the presentation over to Erica Roberts, our computer science teacher, so she can discuss the other two aspects of instruction that we found most necessary to adjust in order to make the curriculum accessible to students with learning differences.
Hi, everybody. I hope you can all hear me. I remember to unmute my phone. Much of the code.org curriculum included a lot of collaborative work, and that was to help the students get used to working with each other in preparation for the final two performance tasks. And the curriculum had different varieties of collaborative work. There were the think-share-share activities. There was a lot of shared programming. And there was partnered thinking and problem-solving, where students were asked to maybe review an article and then discuss it with each other. So one of the challenges that I had in the classroom was getting the students to used to working with each other. That was a challenge, getting them to learn how to speak to each other appropriately, making sure that they're paying attention to each other, understanding what their partner groups are doing, helping them find the right vocabulary to use when they're speaking to each other. So one of the things that I did in the class was at the beginning of the year, I looked at the class makeup and with the assistance of our learning specialist, we put together some groups of students. So there were opportunities where students had to work with just a partner, and then sometimes in larger groups. So we put together some groups, and I tried to keep those groups consistent through the year, just because I thought it would be helpful for the students to get to know each other a little bit better, even though most of them were seniors. And then for some of the assignments, rather than having them work as partners or a group, I gave them the option to work by themselves. And some of them chose to work on their own, and some of them chose to work with a partner. The biggest challenge that I found in the class was actually doing the coding piece, because even in a block coding environment like what code.org provides, coding can still be very detail-oriented. There's lots of vocabulary that gets introduced. There are lots of commands that get introduced. If you look on the screen, you can see names need to be consistent from one to the other. And helping the students understand that to be the same from one block to another. So if you look on the second bullet point, that there's a difference between APPLE1 and APLE1. Those are things that are very can be very confusing. I had a couple of students that insisted on, rather than using the block, coding in the actual code. So what they did was, you know, then they have to worry about semicolons and structure, and that made it a little bit more challenging for me. What I did do was I had the students on several occasions, I had them create a reference sheet of all of the variables that they were using, so they would have a visual cue to remind them of the spelling that they were supposed to be using, as well as on many occasions I brought them back to the electronic documentation for the AppLab environment, because obviously it's important for the students to learn how to be a self-sufficient problem solver, not just always relying on me to point out the examples. So I would refer them to the AppLab documentation very, very often. Okay. That's all I have, so I'm going to turn it back over to Sarah.
All right. Thank you, Erica. And I know we were having a little bit of a sound issue. I think some folks on the phone, if you could mute your phone so we don't hear background noise, that would be really helpful. Thank you. All right. So thanks to Daphne and Erica for sharing some of these instructional practices and some of the things that they've tried out at Wolcott School as part of this project that seems to be helpful. And to kind of wrap that up, you know, I want to just drive home the point that some of these things that we're talking about that are going to make computer science classes and materials more accessible for students who have diagnosed learning differences, this is something really critical, and this is a big piece of, as we talk about as a community, broadening participation in computer science, we have to also consider these students. And we need to kind of think about what are some ways that we can, you know, as the next step, think about make some of these adjustments to some of the instructional materials that we have an opportunity for students. And there are two really big reasons why this is important. And first and foremost, of course, it's an issue of educational equity. You know, students who learn differently really have to be kind of afforded the same economic and social mobility opportunities as their peers. We're constantly hearing about how important computing skills are, 21st century skills, and these students need to have the same access to those learning opportunities as other students. And second, you know, overlooking these students means that the field as a whole really misses out on the type of creativity and talent that they can bring to thinking about, you know, contributing new ways to view the world around us, generating novel approaches to tackling some of these complex problems we've not yet solved because of their learning differences. They're oftentimes really well equipped to bring that fresh perspective. But if, you know, they don't have the chance to participate, we can't benefit from some of their views, and that's lost if they can't fully participate in some of these opportunities as they're currently presented. So it's our job to really think about ways that we can make some adjustments that are going to make it more accessible for them. And we're talking about, you know, a large segment of students too. This isn't some very small segment of the population. You know, and we want to capture that creativity and talent. When we did a final kind of exit interview for all the students who were on our research team at the end of the school year with the computer science principles class, one of the things we asked them was, you know, what traits or characteristics do you have as a result of your learning difference that make you really well equipped for computing, for doing computer science? And some of the responses that you can see here on this slide provide a pretty clear picture as to how these students can help, you know, bring something really great and novel to the computer science classroom and the professional field as a whole. So some students talked about creativity and problem solving. You know, you're thinking outside the box. You're thinking differently than everyone else. A lot of us have always been on the outside. So I think that type of thing puts me and other kids with learning differences at an advantage because we're able to critically think in a more, you know, creative, solving way instead of just being logical. You know, one student talked about being really good at figuring out problems, finding different ways to solve a problem, and how that directly related to programming and coding. And other students talked about the drive that they have to not give up. You know, I will keep trying and doing whatever I need to do in order to succeed, asking for help, stepping out of my comfort zone, raising my hand when there's 400 kids. I don't really care as long as I'm understanding it so that I can succeed. Right? I hate quitting. So these are the types of things, these are traits that we want to have in students in our computer science classes. And when we don't, aren't making things accessible for students who have learning differences, then we're missing out on this. So in conclusion here, to make sure that we have some time for question and answer, we have just really two big takeaways for you. One of them is look to students as experts in how we can improve the computer science principles as well as just a general computer science experience. Students are the experts here. They're the ones who've been going through these classes. They have a lot of feedback for us and useful information, and we really want to make sure that we highlight their expertise because that's really important.
Welcome to Verizon Wireless. The wireless customer you called is not available at this time. Please try your call again later. Announcement 1, switch 94-1.
Can you all still hear me?
Welcome to Verizon Wireless. The wireless customer you called is not available at this time. Please try your call again later. Announcement 1, switch 94-1.
Okay, so someone has, thank you, if you can mute your phone. So the last thing that I wanted to say was, you know, we want to make sure that we're using a range of instructional practices to make it easier for all students, and particularly those who have been diagnosed with learning differences, to access and engage in computer science learning. So you can see here we have a link to our project website where you can learn more about our work, access some resources that we have. But I also want to kind of point out we're not the only ones in the computer science space that are doing some of this work. We do have a few other colleagues who also are giving attention to students who have learning differences and disabilities in general. So there is a special education computer science professor at University of Illinois, Maya Israel, who she and her team have been looking at the elementary level and thinking specifically about universal design for learning in computer science classes and how that those types of instructional practices are helpful for a wide range of different kinds of learners, including those who have learning differences. And then, of course, there's the Access CS for All group and website, which has resources for ECS and CSP teachers relating to thinking about students with disabilities in general. They also have a really great, you know, there's a phone number and an email address that you can use to kind of get some real-time responses and feedback for questions that you encounter in the classroom along the way. So with that being said, I'm going to turn it back over to Maria, and I think we have time for some questions and answers.
Yes, we have exactly 14 minutes. So feel free to either type your questions on the chat box, or you may unmute yourself and make place your questions by talking. So I'm going to do my best and read the questions that are in the chat.
So don't be shy. We really want to hear from you and about some of the experiences that you've had, some of the challenges you've encountered, some of the successes you've had, things that you're thinking about if you're going to be teaching the course next year, things you want to be prepared for.
And by the way, this is not about the presentation per se, but there was a question about the link to the recording. And yes, that will be shared on the CS for All Teachers website on the event post. So in a couple of days, it will be available for everybody, so you can just show it to other people. And I'm just scrolling through the chat to see if I see anything.
So I see a question about performance tasks and working on them earlier. Any suggestions? And so I'm going to throw that one over to Erica, computer science teacher. Maybe you can share some expertise and some suggestions in that space.
Absolutely. I would definitely suggest working on them sooner rather than later. If you're using the code.org curriculum, I actually modified the order that I taught the class. I taught units 1, 2, then 4, then we worked on the explore task, and then I did units 3 and 5 together because those are both the programming. Unit. So I thought that it would make sense to make a clear cut between the performance, between the explore task and the create task. I hope that helps.
Thank you.
Sorry, Maria.
There is a question from the fellowship.code.org. They're saying if there are any suggestions for what they can do to improve accessibility.
So that's a great question. This is Sarah again. So code.org crew, we've actually been in communication with Baker Frankie about some of the things that we've learned through this project working with the code.org version of CSP, and we have shared some of our thinking around that with him that's actually being shared with the CSP teachers who are going through PD this summer. And so some of the things that we've suggested relate to some of these more kind of like general kind of reoccurring types of activities that we identified as happening throughout the CSP course. And these are things that, you know, certainly we found in the code.org version of CSP, but that are also going to be common in other CS classes. And they're just simply things that have to do with, you know, reading and writing, discussion, some of this collaborative work that Erica talked about, things like that. And so we were able to create I just put the link in the chat box again, but a general kind of like teaching practices guide that covers things that teachers can do, ways to think about instruction for activities related to reading and writing, collaborative work, discussion, some of the exploratory project-based work that Daphne talked about in programming activities. In addition to that, some of the work of our project has been to, as Daphne spoke about earlier, go through, review every single code.org CSP lesson, and then also create very lesson-specific recommendations for teachers tied to particular places within those lessons, where some of the instructional practices and suggestions from the Wolcott specialist team can be used. And so we've shared some of those units and some of that material with code.org already, and our plan is that, you know, by the end of the summer we'll have those lesson-specific recommendations for the entire set of code.org lessons that we'll be sharing on our project website so that others can benefit from that as well. Again, I also know that the, you know, Richard Ladner and his team at University of Washington, the Access CS for All group, they have other great recommendations that are more applicable to students with all different types of disabilities that are helpful for any CS class. I see Erica is having a back and forth discussion in the chat with a few different people. Daphne, do you have anything you want to kind of add to what I just noted in terms of general things that code.org or any curriculum developers, you know, should be thinking about or paying attention to as they, you know, go back and kind of think about ways to do the next version of their instructional materials?
Well, like as you said, you know, we did go through, like, you know, many of the lessons provided like some very specific examples. I would say just having gone through, you know, the code.org curriculum, I would say, you know, in general, it would be good to sort of vary like the ways in which information is created. Like it seems to sort of follow like a very specific pattern of like, you know, think, pair, share, and then some collaborative work, and then some follow-up discussions. And those are all great, like independent tasks, that if you do have students that have some language difficulties or some social dynamic challenges, it's almost as though like every aspect of the lesson may pose a challenge, you know, over time. So I would say maybe varying some of the ways that things are approached, so that, you know, all, you know, I guess everyone's strength will be tapped at some point, and then, you know, and then if there's a challenge, it's not going to be a continual one. But also, like we talked about earlier about the language pieces, I think just really recognizing that there is a lot of new vocabulary being introduced and new phrasing that's being introduced, and at times just pausing and highlighting it and providing good reference materials that students can access you know, as they're moving forward.
Yeah, so. That's great. Thank you. And I'll just add on to that, you know, I'm looking at some of my notes from some of the student interviews that we did early on in the school year where we were, you know, students had gotten through code.org Unit 1 and Unit 2 lessons, and some of the things that stood out to us, the things that kids identified as some of the challenges that they were encountering in the course itself. And those are things that, you know, we can all think about as a community and pay attention to when those things come up in lessons or thinking about writing of lessons. But, you know, there are some things that for some students, you know, while collaborative and group work is really great, and that's a way, something that can be a support for some students, it can also be a big challenge for various reasons for some students. You know, we had some students who talked about struggling a bit with either, you know, lack of attention to detail on their part, you know, not looking at something or being able to kind of process everything carefully, or spending too much time, too much attention to detail, thinking about things too much in depth, not really knowing what they need to do to take it to the, you know, for the next step. You know, for some students, some of the math work is a challenge. And so some of the things that Daphne has identified in some of the lessons are, you know, alternate things that teachers can do for students who may have challenges related to math. You know, a lot of the students find it helpful to get some type of immediate feedback from teachers along the way as they're going through activity lessons. Some of them need more time, you know. Some of them felt that things were a bit rushed, you know, only spending like 5 or 10 minutes on something and then kind of moving on to the next thing. So really thinking about how to set aside some of that time and space for students to have more of an opportunity to kind of understand something and to kind of process it, you know, thinking about how instructions are written and how easy to understand they're going to be for students, you know, this processing and understanding new content and new vocabulary can be challenging for all students, right? And then when you layer that on the students who have different types of particular learning differences, some of that can also be challenging when you're learning new words or concepts in a very new context, you know, things that they know in a different context and now they're talking about it somewhere different. See, so any other questions? As we have just maybe 3 more minutes here.
We have a couple of people typing things, so. But please feel free to either speak up or, yeah, as Sarah said, type something in the chat. So we have some advice from Dustin about his experience teaching the course in a self-paced way. And Lacey is saying if you have any alternative lesson ideas posted somewhere.
So Lacey, we don't right now, but we will by August. So that will be... let me give you again our project website where we will have those posted. You can find general recommendations at our website right now. Here's the project website, but we're working on that right now to kind of refine those and process and refine those. And those will be available by August.
more advice from Lacey. Stem sentences help her with the students when writing.
Yes, and that was something that is, yep. Yeah, Lacey, we found that that was, Erica, the computer science teacher, also thought that that was a really helpful tool in her classroom as well.
Great. So we're right on time. Thank you so much, everybody, for attending. Thank you to Sarah, Erica, and Daphne for presenting. It was a great presentation. As I mentioned before, the recording for this webinar will be available early next week on the event post. There will be some feedback from the webinar and where to get the recording so that everybody can access it, and that will be on the CS Role Teachers website. And if you have any questions, feel free to email us at csroleteachers@air.org. You can find the email address on our website, and we're more than happy to address any issues that you may have or put you in touch with the presenters if needed. Sarah, anything else you want to say to wrap up?
No, that's it. Again, I just put a note to Lacey. If you want to post your email address here, I can make a note to send you a notice in August when our lesson-specific adjustments are posted to our project website. Feel free to do so.